Ladies and gentlemen, today with us, Mr. Bill Houston, CEO and chief innovator of Twilight Science. I've known Bill for about 16, 17 years. Very, very lucky to call him a friend of mine. He's been in the sign industry for over 31 years. He is one of the most innovative people I've ever met in my entire life. Truly, he has a passion for the sign industry. He has a passion for laughing. He has a passion for all things that are good. And we are going to get to explore that a little deeper. I got my buddy, as always, Mr. Lee Murphy from Access Signs, myself, Robert Blythe from Numax, and I'm going to turn it over to Bill Houston. Let you introduce yourself. Tell us a bit about yourself, Bill.
Thanks, Robert. Really appreciate you guys doing this. It's really been amazing, and I'm happy that you're getting so many people watching at this time. So as you mentioned, Robert, been really amazing to be in this industry for over 30 years now. Our company, Twilight Signs, we specialize in branding for retailers and anybody that has spaces outdoors or spaces indoors. And in addition to fabricating a whole wide variety of signage at our facility here, we also involve ourselves pretty uniquely with design and creating things for clients and helping them reimagine their spaces in ways they never thought possible. So that's part of the special sauce to doing anything great, is coming up with what's possible and collaborating with our customers to really come up with something that's going to be amazing.
So Bill, thank you so much for being here today. We'll start off with a few questions. So first off, I guess everyone has a different insight or experience with the pandemic going on right now. How are you, your family, and team dealing with the situation we're going through at the moment?
Yeah, well, it is unique. So for us, we ended up, you know, shutting down about 80% of our team in and around the middle of March there. With that said, very shortly afterwards, we retooled some of our equipment and the things that we're doing. We're now producing a whole host of safety barriers for restaurants that are still delivering takeout. A whole pile of companies' medical side that we're working on now. How we're keeping safe, basically, we've got appropriate measures in the factory and the office. Don't have a lot of staff here, but just taking precautions to make sure that the people are still safe and comfortable working. And just trying to keep the anxiety down, because a lot of people really are extremely uptight about this situation. Others, not so much. I wouldn't say that I feel a lot of anxiety in terms of getting sick or unhealthy, but it depends who you talk to. So those are the things that we've been doing in terms of our family. A lot of Zoom calls, not just locally. I've got a daughter that's in Spain. She arrived in Spain on March 10th, was going to stay there for a year. And she decided that she was going to stay and be in quarantine there until the dust settles. And she's doing fine. So yeah, it's different. You know, fortunately for most of my immediate family, we do have backyards, and we're making use of getting outside to some degree, because I think that's really important. Get some sun, get out, get moving, walk around, get some fresh air. I think trying to keep some normal in our daily routines, whether it's after work or especially on the weekends, helps make sure that our mindset remains positive, and that, you know, we're all realizing that this is very new territory for us, but it's a short-term situation that we're going to come out on the good side eventually here. So
Yeah.
How'd you get involved in the sign industry, Bill?
Well, I started in the sign industry like I think a lot of other people did. I fell into it accidentally. When I was in college, going to school for CNC programming and operating at Humber College in Etobicoke, ended up picking up a part-time job, working there usually one day through the week and on the weekends, depending on my schedule. Really just working in the factory, learned about building signs, installing signs, etc. Worked there full-time through the summers, two summers when I was at school. And eventually went into my own field, kept working part-time for a little while for this company. And they ended up deciding to move backwards and get out of the manufacturing side. And for the longest time, I always felt that I wanted to be an entrepreneur, wanted to be self-employed, and offered to basically purchase all the equipment, take over the lease at the small sign shop that I was working at, and start my own business up. Didn't want to become partners with this gentleman at the time. So I started my own company up, and for about a year and a half, basically, this company continued to sell, would subcontract the manufacturing work to us, and they kept their trucks. So they were still continuing with installation and service. So they handled the installation side. That relationship worked for about a year and a half. And for a number of reasons, I decided that I was going to kind of break out on my own, and did so. And pretty much went from having as much business as I could make to almost very little. Had to quickly learn how to sell. And took a sales course, started banging on doors of large multi-location customers. And probably within about a year, got back to the same level of revenue that I was at previously, working for this other gentleman on a subcontract basis. And I call that first year and a half my apprenticeship in the sign business. At the time, I was only 20 years old. And I was doing business for pretty large franchises. And if they ever knew they had a 20-year-old making their signs at the time, they would have freaked out big time. So we were doing signage for Color Your World and Second Cup and Black's Photography, companies that had hundreds and hundreds of locations across Canada, and had no clue that there was this young dude with lots of piss and vinegar in his veins figuring out how to build signs.
Piss and vinegar is a not often used term anymore. Absolutely love it.
Because he's my age, that's why.
Yeah. No fear of failure at the time. I also started my family when I was 20. And so anyways, we kind of started banging on doors. And my first year we did business, which was started in 89, our revenue was $110,000. And I took home $10,000 that year, which even back then was not enough to get by on, by far. And so anyways, fast forward, one of our customers was Music World for quite a few years, and had a good relationship with them. And the guy that the decision maker there, the construction manager, used to always say to me, he says, did you hit a million yet? Did you hit a million yet in terms of annual revenue? He'd ask me every year. And I'd say, nope, not yet, nope, not yet, nope, not yet. So it took us 10 years to hit a million in revenue. So that was right around the year 2000. And that was a big milestone. And as soon as we hit it, I called him up. I said, Joel, I said, we did it. He goes, what did you do? I said, we hit a million.
Hit 10 million yet? Did you hit 10 million yet?
Yeah. So anyways, fast forward to that, you know, we've continued to grow. Always some ups and downs in every business that have been around for 30 years. But yeah, you know, we're doing, you know, sort of $5 to $8 million a year in revenue now. So it's been really good, learned a lot, and it's a great industry. And I also often say to people that we're a bit of a hidden industry. You know, everybody kind of knows signs are there. Yeah. Nobody really knows where they come from unless you are in some way related to this industry. Mm-hmm. And I also say to people that, you know, once you've been in it for about a year, you're kind of hooked. It doesn't really let you out either. And it's infectious because we've got a tangible product that is often never the same every day. And it gives a really strong sense of personal reward to most of the people that are in this industry. And yes, we have, you know, accountants and other people that are super important, but they don't tend to get the same sort of personal satisfaction out of their work, even though it's different, you know. Reconciling, you know, the month for them is a real highlight to get all those numbers lined up and everything. I suppose engineering might be the same to some degree, Robert.
But, if it doesn't fall off the wall, I'm a happy guy. That's all that matters.
And please, I'm not taking a shot at anybody here at all in different different sides of the business, but for a lot of the guys in the factory and design and sales and in a lot of the areas where you've got your hands directly on the product and creating it or making it or putting it up, once you're done and you've got the picture or you just light it up in the factory and you've done something that is, you know, just hits it right out of the park in terms of the impression and something really creative and new that nobody's ever done before, that feeling is really what gets us up in the morning. And, you know, the days when things don't go well, then, you know, that keeps you going. So you push through whatever challenge that you have. So it is a really amazing industry. And I think most of us love the fact that it's not the same every day. So
I sat with Bill about 10 years ago at a supper. He and I went out for supper one night. And I can remember most of the conversation. So it was either a really good night or a bad night. I don't remember, but there was some drinking, as there often is with Bill. Okay. But he said something to me that had stayed with me, and it stayed with me all these years. And he said, you know, as a sign company, we need to be more innovative towards our customers. A lot of customers just buying signs, buying channel letters and so on and so forth. We need to be more innovative. We're going there. We're putting up the pylon. We're putting up the channel letters. How come we're not doing the signage on the inside of the stores? And how come we're not bringing new products to our customers? We're just fabricating what they want. We're being cookie cutter. And as long as I've known Bill, he's tried to get out of that mold. And I think he's done a phenomenal job. I'd like you to address that mindset that you have, Bill. It's within the company. It's all about innovation.
Yeah. You know, since day one, you know, we tend to need to have, I call them widgets in what we make, you know, the channel letters, the sign boxes, the awnings, the cutout letters, the kind of easy stuff that it's necessary. Absolutely. But where myself and a lot of our team really get jacked about is when somebody comes to us and says, okay, we want to do something that is totally different, totally new, or take a concept and really, you know, hit a home run with this and take us from, you know, where we are within our competition and, you know, take us well beyond our competitors so that people start, you know, trying to model what we're doing. take what sort of the standard is and do something that really wows people in terms of visual experience. So our team is always gets jacked about doing something different, including in that, you know, so many times over the years, people are coming to us when nobody else wants to touch something. So being really innovative in terms of how can we get something done, how is it possible, has been a big part of what we do and what people recognize us for. We've also invested a lot of time and energy with not just what's available in the North American market. I've been traveling abroad, particularly in China and Europe, for more than 10 years now on a regular basis, and have invested time in trade shows that are 10, 20 times the size of the ISA show in North America. And there's so much innovation and new technologies that have stemmed from overseas. They tend to be anywhere from 2 to 5 years ahead of where we are in North America. I think it's starting to shorten a little bit these days. We're kind of catching up in North America. But taking some of that, those ideas, sometimes it's an individual product, sometimes it's a material, and taking that and then, you know, rethinking how we might be able to use that in a really creative and innovative way for our customers has been invaluable to us, particularly when we've got clients that are looking for something that's super different and don't want to be following a trend. They want to be trend setting. And that's really where we get excited. And particularly when you're working with a client that's got a decent budget and really, really important to get it right. Those are some of the really fun and exciting projects that that we get involved with.
So speaking to that innovation, where do you see the sign industry going? Where would you like to see the sign industry go in the future? And give us some like foresight.
Yeah, sure. Well, you know, I would say it's not terribly different than if I were to answer this question 2 months ago, but I will say,
do we need to break out the slides again?
but I will say it is going to be different. So, you know, for me, I think that when we're talking about the consumer going to public space, outdoor, indoor, in the past, and what's really, I think, been an important ingredient for people that have brick and mortar is that it's more than just a product. These days, it's more than just a location and having a good location. It needs to be way more than that. People will go out to buy if you've got products, if you've got a good service, if you've got a good location, but you need to entertain people in some way. So that how that looks to me is you need to be a visually entertaining people besides on the storefront just having a set of channel letters. You know, it needs to be inspiring. It needs to be to some degree creative on the outside to model, you know, who your business really represents. And then when you get in the inside, it really needs to be experiential these days. Some examples of that is InDesign, the digital. There's a wave now of augmented reality that's going to become part of the interaction through the space where it might not actually be something physical that is there, but through your smartphone or an iPad or a set of glasses, we're going to see people starting to interact with the store space digitally. And those are going to be things that people are going to be looking for. There needs to be a cool factor to what you experience when you're in that space. Robert, you mentioned about Canada Goose experience, where I don't think they sell anything at the store, but they provide an experience.
That was the most incredible experience I've ever had in a store. First of all, there was a lineup to get in and you had to wait your turn. And I've never experienced that. And then of course, all the digital aspect and the experience of walking on ice, which was breaking below you, hearing the wind, hearing a lot of cold, feeling cold, walking into a room, there was only one jacket that you could try on and or you could learn about. And then going to another room where they had every model and every size of jacket they sell, and then you can put it on. You can go into a room which was at minus 30 degrees and snowing. And it'll be like that in summertime. And if you wanted to buy a jacket, you weren't going to buy it there. You could hand them your credit card or whatever, but they would ship it to you the next day. You couldn't leave the store. And that eliminates stock turnover. That eliminates a whole lot of carbon footprint. It eliminates shipping and receiving problems. It faster turnaround on new products, introduction of new products. I mean, it's phenomenal. It was the most incredible experience I've ever had. And we talked about that at the Vision 2020.
So to add to that point, Robert, the point is that if you have brick and mortar, you don't necessarily need to walk out with a bag to be successful. And that's a good example of it. But if you look at that same company, Canada Goose, would you order a like to Amazon the same products without being able to test it, try it, experience it? My answer is no. Not everything is going to be bought online unless people have had an opportunity to test it and to experience it. So when I talk about experience, I speak to senses. We all as people thrive on being stimulated. So touch, feel, see, smell, taste. You know, whether it's a retail store or a restaurant or another public space, think about it. What elevates your experience? The more of those senses that you stimulate, the better the experience. You walk away with warm and fuzzies inside. And if you're going out to shop, if that's your objective, you're gonna, with those warm and fuzzies and your emotions up, what do? You buy, right? You pull your credit card out. To take the opposite side to that of a business model that doesn't stimulate the senses to the same degree, and even worse, you walk into a space where there's frustrations that you experience. So some of those frustrations are, imagine walking into a retail space and you walk in the door, you have some ideas of what you're thinking about wanting to look at or buy, and you look up and all of the wayfinding is just really convoluted and it's confusing. Well, where do I go, right? So retailers and people with brick and mortar need to think about also eliminating as many of the frustrations through the buying cycle as possible, because it's two-sided. Eliminate as many frustrations standing in line.
Yeah,
that is even more of a hot topic as we come through this period. People's tolerance for standing in line, in my view, is going to be more of a frustrating point. And it's intentionally getting worse because there's going to be some social distancing that is going to be measures in place. So how do we get past that? Even though we have to social distance, what are the solutions that brick and mortar can provide to try to eliminate that? So again, it's all about stimulating the senses that give you a positive experience and eliminating as many as possible that could be frustrating or pain points through the buying experience.
Yeah.
You had mentioned previously about hitting it out of the park. And I think that's very accurate in our industry. Sometimes you miss, sometimes you nail it. For the ones you did hit out of the park, does one stand out in your mind about a large accomplishment, your largest accomplishment in the industry?
Boy, there's been a lot. you know, I, I'm going to say a few. Recently, we did a project for Scotiabank at the old Air Canada Center, now the Scotiabank Center. The interior signs that are at Gate 1 and Gate 5. Gate 1 is right at Union Station there. We're able to come up with a really amazing design that pretty much came from almost a handkerchief design from the folks at MLSE and Scotiabank. And to make a long story short, we were able to elevate a whole pile of innovative ideas into the end result and do this within about an 8-week period of time. So was really innovative, really creative, a lot of color in it, animation, and turned out really fantastic and highly complex from a lighting technology as well. So that would be one. And I think also looking backwards a little bit that we won a tremendous amount of awards for about 5 years ago was the project that Robert actually was our film person, which is the premium outlet that we did in Laval about 5 years ago. And we did this, one of the significant items was a 100-foot tower sign that is facing, which highway is that,
Robert? It's Highway 15, just around Mirabel.
Yeah. So it's about a 100-foot pylon sign. It's like a tower with a blade on it. But what's really amazing about that project is that the channel letters on the sign itself were the easiest part, but we were contracted to do everything from A to Z. So we had to engineer it from an art rendering. We had to provide the foundation. We had to provide the whole steel structure, all of the lighting elements that came right up the middle of the tower. All of those being, we switched them all over to LED, built part of this project here, had somebody do some of the steel work in Montreal, and highly complex project from an engineering point of view, and it turned out remarkably well.
It was phenomenal. I remember visiting your shop at the time, and we were talking about it, and there was no room to move. People were passing underneath this thing. It was so big, you know. It was just huge.
Yeah. So those are a couple of jobs that we, you know, visually, the customer satisfaction level, the uniqueness of the job, and being able to execute it either as good as what you were expecting on a rendering, and often it's way better. It turns out way better than what the picture, what the drawing looked like. That's tends to be the way I measure hitting it out of the park. We tend to see some things that look great on a computer screen rendering, or, you know, printing them out on a physical drawing. But when they are three or four times better in person, that's when I call it, we hit it out of the park. And it's a really good feeling for the whole team and for the customer, more importantly.
Yeah, exactly. Bill, we only got a short time here together. We'd love to stay and chat and learn more, but if somebody wants to get in touch with you, what's the best way to do that? Tell us about does Twilight have an Instagram? Give us the whole social media rundown on Twilight.
Yeah, we do have Instagram. Obviously, we have a website with Twilight. We have a LinkedIn page also for Twilight, a Facebook page. I think we're on Twitter too. I'm not a Twitter guy. But yeah, pretty much through all of those channels, you can find us. And we tend to be posting things usually at least weekly, sometimes more than weekly, not just about what we're doing or examples of what we're doing, even though that's some of it, but also, you know, trying to be thought leaders. And one of the cool posts that we do usually weekly or bi-weekly is Throwback Thursdays, which is one of my favorites. that's, you may have seen some of these, but we found a old box of photos that are anywhere from 20 to 30 years old in our office here about six months ago. And it just blew me away. The photos of products and projects and the people in action, working on things in the factory or out in the field. So I would encourage you guys to take a peek at that. One of the previous ones that was out there, showed me on a stage.
I didn't recognize you with the hair.
Yeah, it was on a 60-story building in Scarborough, and I was 600 feet up in the air on a stage in the 90s, and really fond memories of being out in the field and taking on really unique and complex jobs. And of course, you won't see me on a stage very often these days. I'm not afraid to jump on one. However, that's usually, you know, best served by our team these days that are the best at that sort of stuff. So, yeah. That's where you can find us.
Thank you so much. In final words, you got a young leader coming up here. What do you think, Bill? Where do you think the future? What advice would you give to a young man coming in or in the sign industry now? Young woman, same thing.
Yeah. I would really encourage you to embrace the technologies that we're seeing come forward. I really feel that mixed or augmented reality is going to be a space that has a tremendous amount of growth. I'll use the example of IKEA that most people have seen, or if you haven't, then just Google it. For them, they basically, through your iPhone or your iPad, you can literally put one of their couches or chairs or any piece of furniture right into the room that you want to buy it and see it there in real time. And it's pretty authentic. It's really, really authentic, so that you're able to visualize your buy before you actually make it happen. I believe that you're going to see that into brick and mortar, both in their inside and their exterior spaces. I would also encourage people to get out once trade shows are back up and running again. They're a really good way to invest a day or two and really get a sense of what materials, what new things are coming. If somebody has an opportunity to go overseas to one of the trade shows, either in China or a Euro shop or a global shop, those types of forums, really, really, really helpful in seeing what's next. And not always is it that, you know, what I find most important about the trade shows that I go to is you're going to see a whole group of things that are on trend right now, and people are selling lots of it. Where the gems are one or two or three things that are very unique, and they're not in the market right now, or they're just in the market, and things that can be trend setting are the gems that you tend to find. And you can't predict what they are or where you're going to find them, but that's often where I feel that those are good spaces to think about what's next. Mm-hmm. And then just considering, you know, the old Steve Jobs philosophy is trying to figure out what people want and show it to them before it exists, you know, and not what people want today, but what do people want a year, 3 and 5 years from now? So I think those are ways that the young people can really contribute looking ahead here.
Perfect. Lee, any final thoughts before we say goodbye?
Just one. I had no idea Bill and his team were the ones who did the Mirabel Outlets Tower beside the highway. And I don't think many people realize that was built inside a factory. It's something that you can be seen from, I want to say, 1,000 feet away. Yes. It's immense. And to think that was built, albeit in pieces, in a sign factory, is something I don't think people consider. And I think people would look at it like the sign on that tower was the large black panel with the Mirabel premium outlets and not the tower. And I think that goes to show you the capacity and capability of the sign industry that we don't just make channel letters, that there's a whole aspect to our industry that most people either don't know about or consider. And that project is a prime example, because I mean, I could only, if you say it's 100 feet, it looks 300 feet. It looks so massive, immense, and imposing when you come down the highway that that project is a perfect example of what the sign industry is capable of doing for its customers if it has some foresight and takes more control over the final process. Mm-hmm. So that's a great example, and I wanted to thank you so much for being here with us today. I learned a lot, and it was great chatting with you.
Thanks, guys. I really appreciate it. And be safe and keep the brain thinking, because there's opportunities with all of us that come through this that we're learning some important things, and the future's good. The future's bright. So try to stay positive.
Thank you, Bill. Okay. Thank you so much for being here with us.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
Wow. Okay. Good stuff.
That was great.
That was good. A little longer than I expected. I'm looking down. It's 44 right now. So
yeah,
that was 44 odd minutes. But some people are just, I feel bad cutting them off, you know? I mean,
yeah, I know for sure. For sure.
I don't know how to do it. I mean, I'm.
But you know what the thing is? People are going to watch. If they don't watch the entire clip, they're going to watch what they want.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. And I guess that's the way it is, sort of thing. So
yeah.
You know?
Hey guys, I wasn't sure if I was supposed to leave or
no, that's fine. We just finish up and we just kind of chat about it and stuff like that. And it's like we you know, we're trying to keep them to 24 minutes. I'm looking down and it's 44 minutes now. So I'm gonna have to cut some out, because I don't want people to get bored with what we're doing.
Yeah.
You know. So I want to take the most important parts of this and create a great video, which, you know, is a lot of editing on my part, sort of thing. But yeah, we'll get it done. You know, and but Bill, you were fantastic.
Yeah.
And the insight you have is tremendous. I mean, fantastic. It's huge. And by the way, if you really want some great pictures of the Montreal Premium Outlets, you let me know. Okay, Lee, I got them right here.
No, but it's a good example of people have no idea what goes into a sign, or the capacity of a sign company, or the project scope. I mean, literally, you would assume that the sign portion was the black backer on each side with the channel letters, mm-hmm. not the actual structure.
Yes.
And the structure literally looks like a carbon copy of the architecture on the premium outlets on one of the many entries with the gabled roof and everything. And it's wild to think that a sign company built that. It wasn't a construction company who built it. It was a sign company who built it, who engineered it, who did the base, who did the from A to Z. And I don't think people consider what goes into signage. I think they think that it's something that's screwed onto the wall, or that a robot makes, or I always use the thing a robot makes. Like, no one understands the complexity of what really goes into a sign.
Yeah. No. It's true. And when I said that a lot of the time people come to us with projects where nobody else wants to do it, I'm not saying nobody else wanted to do that project, but I will tell you that I think a lot of the other competitors were afraid to do it.
Yeah.
Because there were a lot of unknowns. And not everybody could do it. Not everybody had the energy, the capacity, and the confidence level that you can do something that's never been done before. I can't say how important that is. If you believe you can do it and you have the confidence, even though you don't know how all of the solutions figured out up front, as long as you've got enough confidence in yourself and your team, pretty much anything is possible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's
hey Lee, I want you to get onto Bill's LinkedIn and grab that picture he's got there. It's a really good looking professional picture, and then you can do your stuff. If it doesn't work, just contact Bill and get another one.
No problem.
We got to go, because we got another one in a few minutes. So
all right, thanks guys, talk to you later.
All right guys,
all right, bye.
See you later.